This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
Okay, right. To carry on our next session, we have David Chasner from the Sanford School of Public Policy at Duke University. David, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you. Really interesting talk so far. Really enjoyed. Very happy for the invitation. Just the topic of the conference, it kind of reminds me a little bit. I think, you know, we have some gradations here of views, but you know, probably more consensus than we expect. But if you compare the so-called expert debate and compared to what's going on in the public dialogue about this, I think you have to conclude either that we as experts have failed miserably or that we have a very bad communications problem. And I'm reminded, and I give a lot of talks to groups of Muslim Americans because of some of the other work I do, and groups that comprise absolutely no Muslim Americans. And I can guarantee when we're talking about this topic, one thing that always happens is that somebody in the audience of non-Muslim Americans will raise their hand and say, you know, oh, I hear all the things you're saying, Professor Chancellor, but, you know, why don't the moderate Muslims stand up and denounce this terrorism? Wouldn't that help the situation? And then in the groups of Muslim Americans, inevitably somebody's going to say, all we do, all we spend all of our time renouncing violence and renouncing extremism, why doesn't the rest of the world hear us? And so I'm convinced that, you know, all of us can get on the radio and say, well, this is terrorism and this is not, but nobody's hearing us, just like is happening in that debate. So anyway, that's a long way of saying I'm glad we're doing this, even though in some ways I thought it was like, you know, an old topic, but because I think we've been so ineffective, it's probably worth getting back to. I think it's good that I came after John, because I think I'm making a pretty different argument, which is that I think terrorism is a tactic that goes across all these different actors, and it doesn't depend on the quantum of harm. And I think the analysis there was, well, we'll call it different things as these actions, killing civilians for a political purpose, gets bigger and bigger, then we'll call it different things. I think what I'm saying is that terrorism is a tactic that all these different actors use, and we ought to just call it that. So therefore, you have individual terrorists, you have organizations that are engaging in terrorism, you have individuals engaging in terrorism, and you have states engaging in terrorism as well, and all the different gradations in between. So where does that problematic? Where does it make Victor and Laura start jumping out of their seat, I think is the threshold for all of these talks, or it is so far. And I think the biggest red light I'm going to flash on here is that I'm not even sure that this concept of a terrorist organization, because that's where the rubber meets the road here, I think most distinctly, is particularly useful. And I'm going to get back to why that is. And I get to that because when we're talking about the terrorist organization and the activities of a terrorist organization, I think in common parlance and in a lot of our discussion, when we talk about terrorism as a phenomenon, we are principally seem to be talking about the activities of terrorist organizations, Al-Qaeda, maybe ISIS, the traditional ethno-nationalist ones, back a number of decades ago. And my question is, to try to get to this question, Is their set of activities a kind of defined social phenomenon that we can get our minds around and try to then develop a set of tools to deal with that particular social phenomenon, or is it not? So I try to compare it to other social phenomenon, social conditions. Is terrorism a condition out there that we can have a whole set of tools out to try to heal, to try to address? Therefore, you'd kind of say counterterrorism would be that. Can we say that counterterrorism is this coherent fashion? It's something that gets a little bit back to our first talk. So let's think about recession as an economic phenomenon. And we have a very defined set of tools. Economists can vary a little bit about what they are and how they should be applied. But we have monetary policy, we have fiscal policy, we have the support for financial institutions, social safety net spending, job training, and so on and so forth. But we have a very well defined set of tools to deal with that. We call so many things terrorism and apply it to so many different ranges of activities, or the phenomenon of terrorism is being applied so broadly that I think this kind of falls apart to say that terrorism is a social phenomenon. So for example, we have an ISIS beheading of a group of Christians on a beach in Libya. And then we have a disturbed Muslim teenager who shoots up a National Guard recruiting base in Chattanooga, Tennessee. And I would submit that the tools that we need to, that we would use to address these two phenomena, which we would both call terrorism, are basically a null set. There is virtually nothing that we would compare in using these and trying to address these two different things. And that makes me think that terrorism is not a social phenomenon in that way, and that it is much more a tactic. It is just a tactic like certain forms of violence or certain forms of military activity that is used by a variety of different types of organizations. So again, the range of organizations, individuals use terrorism as a tactic, small groups of people, the Mark Sageman bunch of guys, the Boggs use it, organizations use it, and I would propose we might be calling these violent political organizations, because in my mind, that is much what they are, rather than calling them terrorist organizations. And again, we'll get back to that. Up to networks of these violent political organizations, to insurgencies, then to militias or guerrilla armies, to proto-state like ISIS. I think that's a pretty good description, Audrey Kurth Cronin, all the way to states. And to my mind, all of these actors are using terrorism as a tactic. What are the three core elements of this tactic? To give it, we have to have some coherence here. I agree, I think, pretty much with our coders on that, at least, that there has to be a political motivation, it has to be illegal, and it must be targeted at civilians. So why do I say that, well, therefore, you know, since everybody's using this terrorism as a tactic, I don't think we should then, these violent political organizations are using terrorism as a tactic. Why is it we only call them terrorist organizations, but we don't call the state that is using the exact same form of violence, they're using politically motivated, their violence is politically motivated, it's illegal, it's clearly targeted at civilians. When Assad is dropping barrel bombs indiscriminately on his own people, I argue he's engaging in the same structural ideas of trying to achieve a political objective by using fear and violence. So I think when we label these organizations as terrorist organizations, we're somehow saying, well, they have a monopoly on this particular tactic. And I think the comment from before that, well, ISIS is loads of things, you know, is it a dessert topping or is it a floor wax? None of you got my Saturday Night Live reference, okay. It's all different things all at the same time. No, I think that I don't agree with that. The Taliban is an insurgency. Hezbollah is multi-pronged. It's a political party, it's an insurgency, and it's a militia group in all of its different guises, except as, you know, really as a political party, although maybe they're financing terrorism, so you could say they're engaging in terrorism in a tactic in all of those different guises. But therefore, to call Hezbollah a terrorist organization, it seems to me not particularly helpful, not very descriptive. So what are the implications of kind of this idea? I think the first, and the reason I would like to get away from, or I'd like to call terrorism a tactic, is I think the notion that, well, terrorism is out there, it is kind of a phenomenon we need to direct resources at to defeat, undermines the public understanding that terrorism is, in essence, a manifestation of a political conflict. And I see that very much in the way France has responded to the attacks from last month. France is saying, okay, well, terrorism is a phenomenon. It is a set of ideas that are out there. It is a, we need to go defeat terrorism, and the terrorism is flowing from ISIS, so we are going to go and attack ISIS. Rather than understanding that a lot of the terrorism that got Paris, or the terrorism that affected Paris, has its deep roots in this political set of grievances that is affecting a large chunk of the French, or not a large chunk, but definitely a chunk of the French population. But France is not discussing it like that. They're not saying, well, we have an internal problem. There's a political problem here, and we need to get our minds around it. No, it's let's go find the terrorists and use a military means against it, and that will solve the problem. Now, do we have tools to decapacitate various actors that are using terrorism tactics? Yes, we do have those. In different, guises, we're familiar with those. But I don't think there's a public understanding that in the end, that these are going to be much more degrade than defeat kinds of activities. We can reduce the amount of terrorism by using certain other tactics against them, so we can reduce this use of terrorism as a tactic by different actors by deploying certain tools. But in the end, if we don't really try to look at the political conflict and address that political set of grievances in an effective way, well, there'll just be other individuals, groups, or whatever, who will come up with those same grievances and engage in a renewed violence. And of course, we can't see any better example of that than the Iraq surge, which, yes, we use a set of very strong tools. It wasn't just about a large amount of troops. It was about a change in strategy. It was partially the combination with counterinsurgency, but also, techniques where our special forces were identifying people, raiding those people, accumulating the, it's very described very well in Eric Schmidt's book, Counter Strike. Gathering intelligence, going out on a new raid the next day, and when it was done over and over and over and over again, Al-Qaeda in Iraq was gone. It was deeply degraded. But the surge did not solve, or it didn't even begin to start to address the political grievance was what you had, a disenfranchised Sunni population after the invasion of Iraq that was never ameliorated to any degree, and poof, you get ISIS. Surprise, surprise, you have a new actor who's just essentially taken up the grievance, and all of what you did in the guise of so-called counterterrorism is gone. Another implication is, I think it's very hard for the terrorism studies groups, is that states certainly use terrorist tactics. And I'm glad I came after Clark because I'm definitely inspired by his, so I was worried that he's going to take up everything I wanted to say. But this state use of terror and state power to use terror against civilians, of course, creates a reaction, which leads to a spiraling conflict. I'm also very influenced by Martin Miller from Duke's book on this that shows that many of these conflicts are about the contest for a legitimacy and legitimate state power between different entities in a society, the state fighting against groups, groups fighting back against the state, and so on. So what is a state to do if it's faced with some sort of rebellion to prevent itself from essentially being called a terrorist state? And using terrorist tactics? Does it have to allow a violent rebellion to go unchecked? And I would say, no, of course not. And this is where my distinction on my definition between illegal and legal activity, and I think my question to John, and where I think maybe we disagree on this, is that states have a wide variety of legal powers to try to quell a rebellion under both the law of war and under human rights law. They can use force to deal with armed insurrection, and they can use the police to enforce laws, even totally unjust, oppressive set of laws, but it is not illegal for the state to attempt to use those and to enforce the law and to use their police forces to do that. But it can't drop barrel bombs on groups of civilians that kill massive numbers of people indiscriminately, which violates the laws of war, the principle of discrimination. And you cannot use your police to fire into a crowd of protesters and use violence in that regard. And once you have done that, you have violated human rights law, or you have violated, if you're in an armed conflict, international humanitarian rights law. And therefore, you have become a state of terror, and you are using terrorist tactics. And I think it would be very useful for President Obama to identify Syria as a terrorist state, a state using terrorist tactics. And I think it would help in the communications of why we're dealing with the Assad regime the way we are. Okay, what about rebellions and rebels against an unjust government? And that's what's always said, of course, and we heard the phrase, you know, it's the weapon of the weak. Are we decapacitating, by saying that terrorism is out of bounds, are we decapacitating the weak to try to rise up and go against a unjust government? Now, international law has not gone as far as many of the revolutionaries of the 60s and 70s would like, but if you look at the additional protocol to the Geneva Conventions, and I am a little intimidated because I know there are real international lawyers in the room, as opposed to me, definitely an amateur in this regard. But the additional protocols of 1977 identified as armed conflicts under international law, wars of colonial domination, I'm feel good here because I'm actually quoting from the provision, Article 1, Section 4. So wars against colonial domination, alien occupation, and against alien regimes in exercise of self-determination are considered armed conflicts. So you do have the power as a group to rise up against under international law, and you can enjoy the privilege of belligerence if you do so, which would mean, number one, that if you are captured, you cannot be prosecuted for using violence, and if you are captured, you have to be treated as a POW. But what do you have to do if you are in such a rebellious state? You have to comply with the laws of war, that there are criteria for how you have to operate. You can't operate as terrorists. You have to organize yourself in units with a certain command structure. You have to wear some sort of distinctive sign. You must carry your weapons openly. And then, most importantly, you cannot violate the laws of war, which means you cannot violate civilians. You cannot kill civilians. So, yes, you can be, you can rebel against a government, an unjust government, without becoming a terrorist. And goodness, I hate to even, you know, cross the line into talking about Israel-Palestine because that gets us all going. But I think you can really make the distinction between the freedom fighter and the terrorist by looking at these criteria. Yes, I think Palestinians can use force in advancement of their nationalist identity against a occupying force. And let me just say, for the television cameras, I am a Zionist and a supporter of Israel. I just believe in trying to resolve the conflict. Got that out. So yes, they can use force, but they have to do so in a way with these criteria. And they cannot, they have to comply with the laws of war. They can't indiscriminately kill civilians. If they want to try to use force, it has to be against military targets. They can't hide among civilians and do most of the things that the various groups, violent political groups who use terrorism as a tactic, Hamas, Hezbollah, groups on the West Bank do. And so when they do that, they are terrorists. If they are using force in a legitimate way against their war of occupation, a war against what they would say is an unjust, illegal occupation against the Israeli government, that would not be terrorism, and that would be a legitimate form of use of violence. Okay, so, and those are some of my ideas about how to deal with this.
Right, thank you. Hands are up already. I just want to say we're standing between us and lunch, so keep the interventions brief, please, along the way. What's that? Oh, I know, we got 20 minutes, but still. All right, so.
Thank you. So actually, I agree with a lot of what you said. As you were talking about how you don't think that groups should be called terrorist organizations, I just looked at the State Department's website on the list of the terrorist organizations the groups that they declare terrorist organizations, which just to highlight the tension. But before I talk about that,
we could have a list of violent political organizations.
Let me finish. I'm actually, like I said, I'm on your side with this one, and the reason I agree with you is because I think that there is a knee-jerk reaction. As soon as we say terrorist organizations, then we sink into a tactic, just like you said, that isn't productive. And so it becomes very political, and it becomes very important for the leaders to look strong and to basically be oppressive in order to gain their popularity and to get reelected in a democracy and you know, in other reasons and other types of governments. But I do think that in all practicality, though, we could fight a war to get rid of what battle are we going to fight? To have them remove the name terrorist organizations or to actually educate on the discernment across the different types of activities. That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah, it's now. Just it's so incoherent. I mean, to have the Taliban is on the list. I mean, it's too big to be a terrorist organization. It is using terrorist tactics, but it is an insurgency. It is battling. It might ultimately be a political party that becomes part of the future of Afghanistan, or part of it might. Our methods for dealing with it are much different than they would be for a violent political organization, which you know, history shows actually can burn out and be defeated, where insurgencies are, you know, a lot tougher and takes a lot more force and violence to do. Anyway, yeah.
So I'm going to agree with Laura that I agree with most of your points, except I'm going to disagree with your last one, which is, I think the Bader-Meinhof gang, the IRA, and the Taliban can all be terrorist organizations, and the Taliban can be an insurgent organization. I think drawing the line based on size and capability is very problematic, especially given how you were talking about terrorism as a tactic. And I think that if an organization is using that tactic, whether it be provision of social services or attacking soldiers or civilians, we have to attribute that organization to the tactics they're using, which is why an organization like the Taliban can be both an insurgency, a social service provider, and a terrorist organization. And I think that we confuse things.
Do we use counterterrorism or counterinsurgency to deal with the Taliban?
Well, so the line between counterinsurgency and counterterrorism is about as much fun as the line between terrorism and insurgency in terms of how you define it. I think that we do better off if we talk about specific strategies as opposed to grouping them under COIN or CT. And I think a lot of there's so much overlap between COIN and CT. I think it's actually better if we thought about carrot strategies and stick strategies across the board rather than COIN and
well,
CT.
My point is, I think that we, you know, I go back to the 2012 campaign when, you know, Romney said things like, well, we need to double the size of Guantanamo, and what we need to do is put Hamas, Hezbollah, Taliban, Al-Qaeda, and there's this idea that, well, if you call everything that any entity out there that is using terrorist tactics, whether they're an insurgency, whether they're a proto-state, or so on, obviously just get them and throw them in Guantanamo, use so-called counterterrorism, and that's going to do the trick. And there's this idea that we are aggregate, that since they are so-called terrorist organizations, it is totally, we aggregate them all and treat them all the same. And what I'm trying to do is disaggregate and say what we really need is political strategies for dealing with each of these kinds of problems, which are political problems that need to have essentially political solutions. The notion that we can use the same type of, let's call it counterterrorism, to deal with Hamas as the Taliban is crazy. I mean, because it arises out of a totally different political context that is going to require multiple different types of political strategies to mitigate that conflict, take the steam out of it, and that is what is going to lead to a reduction in what we don't like, which is killing of innocent civilians by these different groups. Yeah.
Nope.
Okay, right, then we'll take a break for lunch. Thank you very much, David.
Okay, thank you.
All right, welcome back, everyone. We are going to reconvene, and I'm pleased to introduce my colleague and the former director of the Orfila Center, Mark Jurgensmeyer. And, come on, Mark. So it's been a pleasure taking over the center from Mark, and it's even nicer when basically you're studying different parts of the same thing, and so from my standpoint, it was relatively seamless. Mark, thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Well, thank you very much. I'm sorry I missed this morning session. I would love to have been here rather than where I was, which was getting a prostate biopsy, which is a pain in the ass if you've never had one. But while I was waiting for the procedure, I was watching the news, and of course, all the eyes have been on San Bernardino in the last couple of days. And yesterday, we thought it was likely just a disgruntled employee. On the other hand, a disgruntled employee with kind of military style weaponry and kind of flak jackets. And today, the first creeper that came out was that he had recently been to Saudi Arabia, which looks very suspicious. And it turned out, well, he was on the Hajj. Well, every Muslim goes on the Hajj. It's not suddenly not quite as suspicious as it initially was. But then later on in the creeper, and I haven't followed up with the news since I've come here in the last hour or so, at least one journalistic report is he was in contact with terrorist groups or radical groups. Exactly who, how, what, whether this is even credible information, I don't know. But we may be in a situation where the kind of Paris attacks of a couple weeks ago are now coming to the United States, something we all feared, we kind of expected, didn't want. Is this, in fact, connected? It's one of the things I want to puzzle about. and I want to talk a little bit about the Paris attacks, but I want to begin talking about methodology. And that is how I do what I do, because all of us do what we do in different ways. As Michael said, we are coming to this this moment in history where terrorism as a tactic seems to be more and more prevalent. It's associated with strident religious and ethnic ideologies in a way that's deeply disturbing. It's become a feature of global politics in the 21st century. How to study it? And there's no one way. There are many credible ways and very good ways. I'm appreciative of colleagues who are data crunchers, who take a lot of information that is statistical information of various sorts and run it through data sets and are able to come up with what are often very interesting and persuasive conclusions. Not always, because it depends in part on what your assumptions are and what kind of questions you ask, and you could end up simply verifying your own prejudices. But when it's done well, it's done very well. And I don't discredit any approach to try to understand the various aspects of terrorist analysis. As a preface to saying what I've tried to do in the 30 years that I've been looking at movements associated with terrorism, and I usually call it, I don't use the word terrorist groups or terrorists as a person, kind of like the word murder. You become one only after you've been associated with an act that we regard as terrorism. And we're the ones who define it, of course, not usually the perpetrators, because we're the ones who are terrorized. So by definition, if you're terrorized, you are experiencing terrorism. And that's about it as far as my attempt to identify. I understand for legal purposes and other policy purposes, it might be useful to try to get a fix on these terms, but at least for my purposes, it's not particularly useful. But terrorist acts exist, and the question is why? And the very beginning, the very beginning for me goes back to the mid-1980s, because it was the Sikhs in the Punjab that really fascinated me. This is a group with whom I'd lived for a number of years in the northern state of the Punjab in India. And this awful spiral of violence between the Sikhs and the Indian government deeply perplexed me, and both as a scholar and as a person, somebody who lived among people. And then to see them caught up in this extraordinary kind of fantasy of violence and conflict with the Indian government, I wanted to know why. And that began a trajectory that I've been on ever since. I've taken the insights that I've learned on looking at the Khalistan movement and studying the teachings of Sanjanal Singh Bindranwala and talking with many and many of his followers to try to understand the worldview in which they were a part. And come about an approach to the study of instances of terror and the groups with which they are associated, which essentially tries to look at their worldview. In other words, I'm engaged in what a colleague of mine and I are now calling epistemic worldview analysis. And we're using the fancy word, the kind of made famous by Michel Foucault, episteme, as a kind of nexus of logic that undergirds one's sense of reality. And so what we're trying to do is recover the worldview, the kind of logical structure, the ideas that kind of hold together a world that makes it plausible for sensible, ordinary people to pick up a gun and start shooting at people that are otherwise innocent, defenseless persons, perhaps in the very people who committed the acts in San Bernardino just yesterday. So that's our task, to try to make sense of the worldview, to do an epistemic worldview analysis. And the way which I've gone about it is largely to talk with people in conversations that are meant to be interactive conversations. That is, they're not surveys. My problem with, and I started off trying to do surveys, the problem with that is you're fixed with the questions that you think are right. And what I learned is very often the questions that we begin with are not really the ones we want to ask, or they're not relevant. So I call our approach a kind of relational or interactive form of knowledge, where we're trying to pick up cues from them about their worldview so that we can then ask questions that are relevant to what the way they see the world in order to create this structure of the worldview in which they are engaged. And so often, what I've discovered in many years of doing this is a worldview that's deeply informed by a sense of cosmic war. Remember when I years ago when I interviewed Mahmoud Abu Lima, who was an Al Qaeda related operative involved in the 1993 bombing of the World Trade Center, and regarded by journalists, Time magazine had him on the cover as being the chief organizer of the 1993 World Trade Center attack. And because he was in prison, he'd gone through, you know, a trial in Manhattan and was convicted and sent to prison, he was available for interview. And even luckier for me, he was in prison at Lompoc State Prison, which is just right up the road. So all I had to do was drive up and see him. Well, it was not quite that simple. It took me about 2 years to go through all the red tape. I had to talk with the warden, I had to talk with the lawyers, I had to talk with... Finally, I got my representative to help, you know, intercede. It's almost harder to break into prison than to break out of it. And then I got to talk with Abu Lima. You know, one critical moment, and it was a very affable, jovial fellow, kind of freckled. They called him Mahmoud the Red because he's a red-haired Egyptian and gregarious guy. And at one point, though, when we were talking about the relation to religion and politics, his face kind of darkened. He leaned over close to me, and all the guards around us got scared because they'd emptied out the cafeteria just so we could I could have the interview and be surrounded by guards. And he leaned over me and said, "Mr. Mark," he says, "you people just don't get it. You're like sheep." He says, "You're just blind. You're just stupid. You don't see it. Your newspapers are totally controlled by your government and by the Israelis, and you don't see what's happening in the world." And I said, "Well, what's happening? You're in war. There's a battle between good and evil and right and wrong and religion and irreligion, and your government is the enemy. It's keeping you from seeing the reality of what's going on." I could see the frustration in his voice, and he was almost shaking. And then he said, you people need to be shaken awake. Somebody needs to grab you by the shoulders and show you what's really going on in the world." A light went on in my mind, and I said, "Well, is that why people bomb buildings?" And he just smiled and kind of leaned back, and he said, "Well, now you know." Now you know. And after 9/11, we knew. Because this is an extraordinary performance of what in his mind, and what in their minds, was a battle, a great war. And it looked like a great war. I mean, 9/11 looked like the grade B summer movie idea of what a great war is all about. An extraordinary explosion, extraordinary. And it was not as if this was the beginning of a whole series of attacks, or suddenly there would be gunboats of Al Qaeda operatives landing on the shores of Maryland. No, that wasn't going to happen. It was just, this is it, folks. Get with it. And here's the picture. Almost like mesmerizing, gripping street theater, a kind of performance of conflict meant to draw us and all who witness into that frame of reference, and for a while live in the reality that they had lived in and they wanted to project on the rest of the world. It's an extraordinary form of communication, an extraordinary effort to try to bring us into a view of the world that they had already had, and the degree to which, of course, we responded and began to see the world at war, then their mission is fulfilled. Not just us, of course. They were hoping to get the wider Muslim world to rise up in righteous anguish. And this, Timothy McVeigh was trying to do the same thing in the Oklahoma City Federal Building, trying to get the Christian populace, the remnants of true Christians, to rise up against the forces of secular multiculturalism and reclaim America for the kind of true Christendom that it was. So Anders Breivik, of course, was trying to do the same thing in Norway. These, again, are performances of violence, which is why the title of my paper is Terror as Performance Violence. Performances in order to try to bring us into the world that they have seen, and often with very effective, with great effect. I often describe this as symbolic violence, and I don't mean by saying it's symbolic that it has no strategic significance. Sometimes it can have a tremendous amount of significance. Now let's take Paris. And the Paris attacks, one of my first thoughts when I heard about it, when I heard that there was a likely connection in some way with ISIS, and we still don't know the degree to which it was centrally commanded or whether this was a group, simply a cell in Brussels that decided to undertake this on their own. But unlike Charlie Hebdo, which is more of a lone wolf kind of thing, at least it seems to me, the likelihood of this being a ISIS kind of directed activity is more likely. If in that case, why would they want it? I mean, ISIS is in bad times, in bad shape, really. They're losing money. The infrastructure is crumbling. They're losing land. They're losing all that whole northern part of Syria with the Kurdish inroads. Sinjar just fell, and this was the key location between Raqqa and Mosul, supply road between those two critical cities that are controlled by ISIS. They're in bad shape. Their volunteers have been running away. They've been fleeing. They've been going back to the West. They need a boost. Actually, maybe that explains it. Maybe that explains it. I mean, if in all those circumstances, they want to give the illusion of a great victory, of something huge, why not perform an act of violence so kind of gripping and mesmerizing, right in the face of secular France? I mean, how more secular can you get than secular France? You know, nightclubs and places like that. What better location to get across the point that we're still around, we're still important. And by the way, you volunteers who are kind of leaving in droves, hey, the war is still going on. You've been tired of those computer games and you want to get in a real battle, you know, it's really rad, man, and you know, people are chopping off their heads, yeah, come back to ISIS, don't leave. You know, we're still on the game, we're still in the town. So it may be that, and we don't know the full facts, of course, yet, but it may be that ISIS has performed in this act act of performance violence that will give them some credibility. My information about ISIS is based, probably most of yours, on they have remarkably public they have glossy journals online that you can get. I've also interviewed in the earlier Al-Qaeda in Iraq, in Al-Anbar province. I've interviewed leaders of the Sunni tribal leaders in Anbar region. And then this summer I was in Kurdistan in northern Iraq interviewing refugees of ISIS, people who lived in ISIS-controlled territory to try to get some fix on it. And then I have a colleague at Canada who is actually engaged in Twitter conversation with young Canadians who have joined ISIS, and he's actually in communication with them as they're on the ground in Syria and has a very clear sense of who they are, why they joined the movement, what it means to them, and kind of verifying this idea of joining a great war. They feel like they're not terrorists. They are soldiers in a great war, in a great cosmic battle, and they are kind of going to venerate themselves and create themselves as heroes and martyrs in a triumphant war. But in all of these cases, it's terrorism, not just as strategy, but as performance violence. Those are my initial comments. I hope we have time for conversation. Michael, should I, you want to field it or you want me to?
You field them and I'll get the microphone.
Okay, very good.
Yeah, following up on your remarks, what seems to be the most common form of what's called radicalization is the belief that the West is trying to destroy Islam in the Middle East.
Right.
And it's not, it has to do with democracy and women's rights and so forth. It's basically, we're defending Islam, our way of life, our religion and so forth. And I never understood why they come to that conclusion. You could argue that the West is trying to dominate the Middle East, recolonize the Middle East, get cheap oil or something like that. But the West is not doing much to destroy Islam. It works with Islam anymore. And the British, when they're in colonized India, didn't try to destroy Hinduism. And you could say, may not want the British in there, but it's not because they're destroying Hinduism. So how do they come to the conclusion that the West is basically trying to destroy Islam when, you know, they keep mosques open, they work with people who are Muslims, they may be puppets and so forth, and disreputable in some respects from their standpoint. But how do they see this as a war against Islam when the United States isn't doing anything really bad to Islam itself, maybe doing a whole lot of other stupid bad things, but not that?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, you know, conspiracy theories are rife in the Middle East. But I remember talking with the head of the Association of Muslim Clerics from Al Anbar region, from Fallujah, when I was in Iraq in 2004, just after the U.S. invasion, and just at the time that Fallujah was the center of activity. It was destroyed once, and then later in the year destroyed again, even more decisively. What this fellow said was, he said, we know why Americans have come to Iraq. And I said, well, please tell me, a lot of Americans are wondering the same thing. He said, it's not about oil, it's not about weapons of mass destruction. He says, it's because everybody knows that Saddam was a CIA puppet. I said, what? He said, oh, yes, everybody knows that. You know, we have pictures. I said, oh, I know. You mean when Rumsfeld was there during the Iran and Iraq war? And he said, yes, that's right. And, you know, so that was proof that Saddam was a CIA puppet. And they hated Saddam, and he was anti-Muslim. And all of the clerics in Fallujah, and Fallujah is kind of the city of mosque, is probably the most, Muslim city in Iraq. They despise Saddam. And I said, well, then you should be happy when the Americans came to liberate. And he said, what do you mean liberate? The Americans came because their puppet, Saddam, was about to fall to the Islamic Revolution. And that's why the Americans need to come in. They need to rule directly because they were afraid that the Islamic Revolution was going to come and take over. And I said, that's the craziest thing I ever heard. So then I started asking around Baghdad, journalists and government officials, and they said, yeah, we believe that, yeah. I mean, we don't think the revolution was quite that imminent, but yeah, we think U.S. is trying to keep down the possibility of an Islamic revolution. But I mean, if you read some of the rhetoric, certainly the neocon rhetoric at the time, there was this kind of clash of civilizations fear that the Islamic world was going to rise up. And scholars here, most people here didn't buy that, but a lot of people in the Middle East did. So we're kind of, blowback from our own kind of exaggerated rhetoric. And then I think the America's support of Israel cannot be, it has to be taken as a significant factor. In Fallujah, for example, that uprising in Fallujah happened just after Sheikh Yassin was killed in Israel. And that main road down which those contractor security people came, and that jeep was then ambushed and then burned, and the bodies were taken out and strung up over a horrible site, and it really kind of then ignited the American anger that to invade Fallujah. That was renamed Sheikh Yassin Street before, and when they capture this Jeep. They said this is in revenge against what you did, in Palestine. So they had made the identity, or they had kind of identified themselves with the Palestinians and the Israelis with Americans in a kind of anti-Muslim cosmic war. And so I don't know, maybe that helps to answer the question. Mia, do you? Oh, I'm sorry.
So I was hoping maybe you could expand a little bit more on the way you viewed ISIS being more assertive, acting abroad to deflect from the weakness within Syria.
Right.
And I don't know if you want to engage in conjecture, but it almost seems to me that some of the extreme rhetoric in the GOP, in the way that they would treat Muslim Americans, and what ISIS is trying to do, it's almost as if both sides of that spectrum are meeting in trying to alienate Muslims, and so that the message becomes the only place for you is Raqqa. So, like, I was curious, and I don't know if you want to get involved in that conversation about American politics, but I was hoping that at least you could expand on this idea that it's about projecting power that you don't actually have in order to draw recruits in.
Yeah. That's interesting. I hadn't thought about that. I'll have to think about it. But I will say that the whole business of trying to create the impression that there's war and that the West needs to go to war with ISIS plays in ISIS's hands. It's really great from their point of view. Because first of all, it helps raise recruits, more volunteers. This really is a global war. It's not just, you know, we're not just a little nasty group that we're trying to put off on the side. But also, if they could actually get a ground war, troops on the ground, man, I mean, that's a war they could win. I mean, bombs from the airplanes, that they can't counter that. But a ground war, that's where they have the support of the Sunni tribal right now, the whole Sunni tribal population of eastern Syria and western Iraq, that's really significant. Now, of course, if they no longer had the support of those Sunni tribals, then ISIS would fall like a house of cards. How could that happen? It already happened. That's how Al-Qaeda in Iraq ended. I mean, the whole point of the Petraeus plan was to try to empower, through the awakening movement, the Sunni tribals. And of course, al-Baghdadi knows that. He was there. He was a part of that leadership structure at the time. And so how are you going to control this? How are you going to control these Sunnis so they don't do this again? Intimidate the hell out of them. That's where these volunteers are so important. That's why you need crazy suicide people who can chop off heads, or they can blow things up with ease, and you can make them do anything they want to. It becomes a very powerful tool. And al-Baghdadi's armor. So getting the idea of war is, and when I heard Hollande say, oh, this is war, oh no, please, you know, no more war on terror, this is going to make things worse. Fortunately, there hasn't been a troops on the ground significantly yet. I just fear that we'll overreact in a way that really does play into ISIS's hands. And then to keep the Syrian refugees from coming, that's great for ISIS. I mean, it's a great embarrassment for them that all these people are fleeing. And I wonder about that. This fear of Syrian refugees all pegged on the one Paris bomber who apparently his passport. What kind of terrorist leaves a passport, or even takes a passport into it? I mean, isn't that a little weird? There was some also contradictory question about whether the picture even matched him. Was this a plant so that people would, Syrian refugees, they're actually full of terrorists. I mean, that's, I don't know, maybe it's a conspiracy theory, but you can see why that would be much to the ISIS's advantage. For this kind of hysteria to develop over Syrian refugees, that then would, he would say, ha ha, you're fleeing us and they don't want you either. Come back home, we'll take care of you, join the Great Revolution.
Ken Harwood, hey. performance, of course, implies audiences.
Yes.
Perhaps you would comment on what you see as primary audiences, maybe secondary audiences, and almost as important, non-audiences.
Well, you're absolutely right. They're very important, and I think they're, and you're also right in saying I think there are multiple audiences. In the Paris attacks, certainly one audience is Muslims abroad, with the hope to get more volunteers to support the ISIS cause. Another audience certainly was political leadership of France, with the hope it would do what it did, but even more strongly, fuel the image of war and engage ISIS on the ground and give it the kind of prominence and respect of a global war opponent. I mean, that's huge. So I think those were the two main audiences. Non-audience, you mean what? And what is a non-audience?
A non-audience is an audience that might be reached but isn't.
That might be reached that isn't. Well, that's interesting. My guess is that the audience that might be reached, I don't know the degree to which people in Eastern Syria and Western Iraq knew about Paris. It might have been a good audience for ISIS in the sense to give people a feeling, oh, we're able to make a strike on a target in the heart of secular Europe. But whether they even knew about it that much, I mean, the communications structure is not perfect in that part of the world. So that might have been the one they would have liked to reach that maybe they didn't reach so well. Well, I thank you for your patience. We had a good conversation.